Blackstone Audio presents Say Nice Things About Detroit by Scott Lasser. For Pam. You think of Detroit in the modern period as a huge, vast African-American ghetto. It's like New Orleans after the flood. Detroit has been through all this, and they didn't even have a natural disaster. It just got washed over by America. John Sinclair. I don't mean to be sarcastic, but there just isn't anyone left to kill. Stanley Christmas, Detroit mayoral candidate, on the 14% drop in the murder rate. 2006. 1. They fled. Tom Phillips to Orlando, Brady Johnson to Dallas, Jeff Lombardo to Chicago, Tim Forrester to L.A. David couldn't think of a single friend from high school who still lived in Detroit, or anywhere near it. David himself had moved to Denver, but now he was back. It was the very first morning of his return that he noticed the photos, a light-skinned black man and a blonde woman, side by side in the Free Press, front page and above the fold. Recognition came slowly, then suddenly. He took the paper and sat down to study it. 3 nights ago, these two had been gunned down in an E-Class Mercedes just north of Greektown, a dozen shots fired at close range. The paper identified the male victim, Dirk Burton, as a retired FBI agent. The woman was Natalie Brooks. The paper speculated on what they were doing in a place and car like that, on whether the killing was racial, which was doubted by a police source who said violence against interracial couples tended not to happen in black neighborhoods. Perhaps the cops didn't know yet they were brother and sister. David dated Natalie in high school, a 2-year affair that fell apart when they went to different colleges. Natalie was the serious love of his youth, maybe his life, unforgettable still. Evans was the family name. David recalled when, as a teenager, he pulled his Chevy into the Evans' driveway and parked behind a large black Mercedes with fat wheels and tinted windows. Natalie walked out of the house with a black man, tall and broad-shouldered. He moved with an athlete swagger. "This is my brother Dirk," Natalie said. David had known Natalie since she was 14, and there'd never been mention of a brother, black or otherwise. The Evans sisters were blonde. They would have been considered fair in Sweden. In the milky summer light, on the edge of adulthood, David sensed that there was an awful lot going on in the world he had no idea about. He learned that Natalie, her sister Carolyn, and Dirk shared the same mother, Tina, a German immigrant who'd made her way to Detroit in the 50s. Later, Natalie related the story of Dirk's birth. Rushed to the hospital when her water broke, Tina was wheeled from the white ward to the black when the father showed up. Then, as now, half white was black. It was the one time David met Dirk. He showed David the Mercedes. They leaned into the car, through opposite doors, their heads together in front of the German sound system. The vehicle, seized from a drug dealer and pushed into service for Dirk's undercover work, was more expensive portable stereo system than automobile. "You can't believe the shit these dopers spend money on," Dirk said. Then he turned up the bass, till the vibrations made David's sternum hum. Dirk looked a little older in the newspaper photo. It had been 25 years, his hair now shaved down to stubble. Natalie was still beautiful, blonde and angular. It was hard to think of them as dead. Natalie especially. It was as if his youth had died with her. 6 weeks had passed since his father called. "It's your mother," the old man said. She was forgetting things. Often she became disoriented, so much so that he could no longer let her drive. She was belligerent. She swore often. "Mom?" David asked. "A blue streak. You can't believe the things that come out of her mouth." David asked what the doctors thought. "Dementia. Wonderful, huh? Like I can't tell that myself. These doctors are no help. There's no cure, just some precautionary things you can do."
"Like what?"
"Lock her in the house, so she doesn't wander outside in her house coat. Still, she can get out. I'm always on guard."
"Geez, Dad,
Jesus, Jesus, Yahweh, Allah, pick any damn god you want. It won't help. David sighed. I need you to come home, his father said.
To Detroit?
Yes, of course. Okay, I'll visit. Not just for a visit. I need you to come and stay.
Stay?
David asked. Only the demented move to Detroit. His father had to know this.
Why?
Because I don't know what to do. At first, David resisted the idea. He was sitting in his office, looking out through the haze to the tawny foothills of the Rocky Mountains, when he decided there was nothing important holding him to Denver, or anywhere. He was 3 years a partner at Cornish & Cole, a position not...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.